Good evening, everyone. To all three, four, I need my 3D glasses, I think, for this. Well, don't worry, it's not going to be Casablanca in 3D, I assure you. My name's Noah Isenberg, and I'm a professor here in the Department of Culture and Media at Eugene Lang College, Liberal Arts, and that's also where I run our film program, Screen Studies, and it's an extraordinary pleasure to welcome you this evening to an event that we have been planning now for several months. And it's great to see all of these friendly faces here in the crowd. I think we're in for a treat tonight with the screening, and then also we're very fortunate to have a couple of people who are going to join me on the stage for a conversation, and we'll also open some things up. We'll open that very conversation up for questions as well. Before we begin this evening, I guess there are a few reminders and quite a few thank yous. The reminders, I guess, if we could please just turn off our cell phones, that would be a great start. But I want to express a few words of gratitude tonight. First to Jessica Hatmanek, who runs the Nth Degree program here at the New School, and it's with her support and the support of her staff that we were able to bring you this event tonight. I also want to thank Nina Quirk-Goldblatt, who's the assistant in the Department of Culture and Media. Many of you have had interactions with her outside, and want to thank her also for her terrific support tonight. Dean Stephanie Browner of Lang College was also very supportive, as was the president of the university, David Van Sant, who expressed his regrets. He'd like to be, he's double booked. You can't dance at two weddings in one night. And finally, of course, to Alex Aleinikoff, the new director of the Zolberg Institute for Migration, Mobility and Migration, there we go. And Tony Scott, who signs his name A.O. Scott in the New York Times, who will be here, both of them on stage, having the conversation. I want to thank them for agreeing to participate in tonight's post-screening discussion. And of course, last but certainly not least, I want to thank all of you for making it out tonight to this event, to this program, again, that we've been planning for what feels like a very, very long time. The story of Casablanca begins here in New York City, nearly eight decades ago, in the summer of 1938, when a high school teacher and aspiring playwright by the name of Murray Burnett made a fateful journey to Europe with his wife, Frances. They traveled by ship to Antwerp, Belgium, and from there to Vienna, where they helped Frances's extended family, her relatives, from Vienna to smuggle out valuables. Jews at that time were forbidden from bringing their precious goods with them in the post-Anschluss, post-annexation period. While they were there, Burnett and his wife witnessed what came to be known as the Refugee Trail, a path that led to Marseille and to Lisbon, in some cases even across the Mediterranean to North Africa and then back. And the lucky ones, of course, were able to travel on to the Americas. Murray Burnett and his wife Frances succeeded in getting the valuables out of Austria. They were on a train. They had a run-in with a conductor. They had cameras stashed. Murray apparently was wearing diamond rings on all fingers. He would have made a great extra in a mob picture. His wife was wearing a fur in the month of August. And they made it. They made it beyond the demarcation lines of Nazi engulfed Europe. They made it into what was still then free France, and ultimately to the south of France. And when they got there, they decided it was time to make their way to a nightclub. And just on the outskirts of Nice, on the bluffs overlooking the Mediterranean, same road that would lead you to Monte Carlo, they entered a smoky nightclub that was filled with people of all different backgrounds, all different nationalities, babble of foreign tongues being spoken at this nightclub. And Murray, apparently, turned to his wife on the spot and said, this would make a hell of a setting for a play. Well, it was when he returned to New York that he, together with Joan Allison, his writing partner, produced a three-act stage play called Everybody Comes to Rick's, what would ultimately, a couple summers later, be translated to the screen and what we're about to see tonight. The point of that small preamble is not only to let you know of the important roots of Casablanca right here in New York City. It also premiered here 75 years ago on Thanksgiving Day, 1942, at the Hollywood Theater in Midtown, what is today a parking lot, I'm afraid. But also to clue you into the very, very important dimension of that refugee trail and of that refugee story that Murray Burnett, together with his wife, Frances, encountered that fateful summer of 1938 in Vienna, Austria. I hope you enjoy the screening, and I look forward to the conversation afterwards. Thank you very much for coming. At the outset, before these distinguished friends of mine here arrived, I gave you a little bit on the story of Murray Burnett and traveling to Europe in 1938 with his wife, Frances, and finding themselves in a position to smuggle out precious goods from Vienna. This was after the Anschluss, after the annexation of Austria by Nazi Germany, as I mentioned in those introductory remarks. It was actually under, at that point, it was Adolf Eichmann who was the head of what was then known as this Bureau of Emigration. And he was responsible for making sure that valuables were not smuggled out. They managed to smuggle them out, as I mentioned in those prefatory remarks, and they made their way to France. And it was there in that smoky nightclub on the bluffs above Nice that Murray Burnett hatched this idea for writing a three-act play, what he and Joan Allison created in the summer of 1940, known as Everybody Comes to Rick's. And the point of that preface, as I said about an hour and 45 minutes ago, was to give you, everyone here in this room, a new awareness of how steeped, first of all, the three-act stage play, Everybody Comes to Rick's, and second of all, Casablanca was with that refugee story. In other words, that it undergirds the entire narrative. And so that's where I left things in the introduction.
I wonder if, sort of following up on that, because this is another really interesting thread in your book and in the story of Casablanca, you could talk a little bit about the other emigre or refugee context, which is the number of people involved in the making of Casablanca and in Hollywood in the 30s and early 40s in the run-up to and early years of the war, and how that milieu of German and Central European and other European refugees in Southern California influenced the making of this and other films.
Yeah, I mean, it really gives the film its flavor. Of the credited players in the production, only three of them were native-born Americans. That's Humphrey Bogart, that's Arthur Dooley Wilson, who had a birthday yesterday, plays Sam, and Joy Page, Jack Warner's stepdaughter, who plays Anina Brandl, the Bulgarian refugee. He comes to Rick and asks for his advice. Of the credited players, only those three were native-born. Everyone else was born in Europe. Many of them were either refugees or had recently been, you know, had fled the Nazis. I mean, whether they still would recognize that as their status is perhaps another matter. When you go into the extended cast, so all of those day players, those bit players, some 75 people who were employed, almost all of them were foreign-born. Many, I'll just give you just a couple of quick anecdotes. Many of the people who performed these bit parts, these so-called day players in the film, had experienced what's being portrayed on film. I give you just one example. Madeleine LeBeau, who plays Rick's on-again, off-again paramour, Yvonne, who gets jilted in the first act, and then returns on the arm of a Nazi officer. She had escaped.
And then tears up.
And then tears up during the singing. Yeah, exactly. Close-up. The close-up of the singing of the Marseillaise, which when she died last spring, the French cultural minister says, you know, she will forever be known as the face of the Résistance. Anyway, she had escaped with her husband, Marcel Dalliot, who was a very, very famous actor at that time. He'd been in Renoir's Rules of the Game and Red Illusion and so forth. They had escaped via Lisbon. So just before the Nazis marched into Paris, they made their way to Lisbon and they got out on a Portuguese freighter using forged visas. They made their way to Mexico. In Mexico, somehow they were able to obtain Canadian visas and cross the border ultimately into California. So they had experienced that. And so when she's singing the Marseillaise, thank you for drawing our attention to that, how could you have missed it? But those tears are real. And it's Dan Seymour who plays Abdul the doorman, who says, you know, he's making this film. He knew that they were speaking foreign language. He knew that they were from somewhere else. But it was in that precise moment when the tears are streaming not only down her eyes, but a number of the extras who were singing in that scene. He says, then he realized they were all real refugees.
I was struck recently, a few weeks ago, I showed this film to a class that I teach. And a lot of the students, one thing that surprised me was how many of the students were seeing it for the first time. I guess because the habit of just watching movies on TV and movies just being on TV all the time has changed a little bit. But the other thing that was striking, talking with them about it and their impressions of it, was I had always seen it when I was growing up and when I was in college as a romantic film with a kind of an undercurrent of politics and of idealism, but that were kind of that belong to the past. And these students saw it very much as a political film and as a film that really spoke to the present moment. I know, Noah, you wrote a wonderful piece in the Daily Beast about a month ago, kind of suggesting the parallels between the moment of Casablanca and the present day. Alex, I wonder if you could speak to that a little bit. You know, what we see in this film that kind of resonates with where we are now.
I'm still in the thrall of the movie in a way, and I've seen this 1,000 times, and it still affects me when I see it. But let me try to focus. So there are some things that work and some things that don't work in terms of the modern day story. And I wouldn't want to try to just say it's all, you know, it all works. First of all, one thing that's interesting. It's a really hard story to follow on the refugee side, right? Until I read Noah's book, in fact, I never knew that there were no such things as letters of transit. And I also always thought they were signed by Charles de Gaulle because, as you point out in the book, it sounds like de Gaulle, but it's actually another. So I learned a lot by
Marshal Vagon. It's just Peter Lorre's accent. Signed by Marshal Vagon.
So I never quite got the refugee story in the movie. And then also, you know, this is Vichy front, unoccupied. What are the Germans doing there? Who really has authority? It's all very murky, which always led those of us who didn't live through that time to see it as the romantic story you're describing. It's a, you know, we see it as this fabulous romantic story. And of patriotism and heroism, even if we don't get to understand the refugee story yet. Now, though, seeing it through my refugee scholar eyes, I actually do see some connections, and it comes up this way. And it's actually a counter story to the story we read in the newspapers in a way. So the story we read in the newspapers now is about lots of people fleeing, a very difficult situation, malnourishment, death on the high seas. It's a story of flight. And this way, of course, the story of flight. The plane takes off at the end. But the way that it resonates with what the untold story of refugees today is these situations that go on forever and ever. So there's the line in the movie about people come to Casablanca and they wait and they wait and they wait at the very beginning, right? That, in fact, is the major story today about refugees. Even though we focus on people trying to get to Europe, it's that there are literally tens of millions of people around the world in these situations that don't end. And in that way, I find a real resonance with, even though, again, we focus on people getting their plane and actually getting out, it's the fact that Casablanca was this place that people were stuck in. Yeah. And that is the modern refugee story, that we don't have solutions to refugee situations today.
Could I draw attention just to one recent piece, and maybe some people in the room read it, and I certainly did. It's in the current issue of The New Yorker. It's by Rachel Aviv. It's called The Trauma of Facing Deportation. In that piece, she does a lot of reporting in Sweden. And there's a scientist in Sweden who's diagnosed a syndrome that is called uppgivenhetssyndrom, or resignation syndrome, which is found among hundreds of children who are in precisely that state of languishing, that waiting, not knowing if at any moment in time you will be deported. And I think that there is this strange, so when the camera takes us, so when Arthur Edison's camera takes us into Rick's Cafe, and we just get those snatches of dialogue of people who are waiting and trying to kind of hatch plans to get out, there are real affinities. Beyond that, too, I just wanted to make one, because I was just trying to kind of flesh this out a bit as I was thinking through that really, really, I found very poignant piece by Rachel Aviv. But there is a comment by Erich Maria Remarque in his novel, Die Nacht von Lissabon, The Night of Lisbon, from 1962, in which he talks about what he calls the refugee glance. And I think when we're brought into Rick's Cafe, a lot of stuff, we get the snatches of dialogue, or we just get these glances. And he defines it as follows. He says, an imperceptible lifting of the eyelids, followed by a look of blank indifference, as if we couldn't care less. And I think there are certain, I mean, I don't want to overstate the connections between then and now, but I think there are certain ones. There are obviously distinctions that you rightly, Alex, made, but I think that there are certain haunting, and this may account, Tony, for your students when teaching your course and showing them the film, may account for some of the political implications that they see. This Swedish critic, Morten Blomqvist, whom I interviewed for the book, he said he'd always thought of it only as being a romance. It was, you know, one of the greatest all-time greatest romances ever. Then he's in Cannes in 2015. Sweden's one of the, this is why Rachel Aviv does her research in Sweden, one of the biggest, next to Germany, one of the biggest recipients of refugees. He sees it in 2015 to do a radio interview, and suddenly he says, it's a refugee picture.
There's another element, I think a more troubling one in a way, a more troubling resonance, which is that this story, the kind of the political fable that it's telling, and you have some wonderful quotes in the book of people talking about a kind of this quintessential American story, that it is a very idealized but also very deeply cherished and resonant picture of, you know, the initial reluctance and selfishness of the American, of Rick as a sort of typical American who might come to the fight too late, but once he's in the fight, he's on the right side, he's on the side of the underdog, and as Lazo said at the end, and this time we'll win. And this was, you know, a kind of almost a premonition of what would become part of the American story after the war.
Oh, sure.
And I just sort of can't help but you know, wonder, given even what's happening, you know, in the last 48 hours, let alone in the last 6 months, what the status of that story is. I think one of the things that troubled my students, that made this kind of a difficult movie in a way that I had never really seen it as a difficult movie before, because it's so pleasurable and so moving, so satisfying in so many ways, is the sense that idealistic story might not hold true anymore.
Yeah, it's one of the great foundational myths or even archetypes, I think, in which we'd like to believe we'll be able to continue to luxuriate over the next generation, if not longer. And yet, it definitely seems as though it's receding. That whole notion of doing the right thing. Even again, as you write, even if you're late to the fight, but doing the right thing, subordinating self-interest for something much larger, and I think this does have implications, Alex, on the current refugee crisis and the lack of of not only the lack of willingness to recognize the crisis, but doing everything that one seems to, you know, in the current regime's power to basically maintain that selfish position that Rick takes early on the first two reels of the film, that I stick my neck out for nobody, that nativist, isolationist stance that he takes, as you know, as half-hearted as it may be in the case of Rick.
Yeah, I mean, there's no question in the movie that these people are headed to America. They're going to be welcomed in. Everyone wants to get to America. That's what the U.S. did. Two comments on this. I picked this up again reading the book, Noah, because people who see this movie as I did in the 60s and 70s and 80s and 90s and every decade after, forget that the movie is made in the middle of the war. So it's part of the war effort, as you very well say. So this patriotism is not just about being there for the little guy, but it's also to support the American war effort in a way. Now think about it. Those people trying to get on a plane to get to America, they're coming from a predominantly Muslim country. Could they even get a visa under the current regime? And certainly, are we on the side of the little guys? Are we on the side of the dictators? Is a question worth asking.
Well, and if the movie were remade now, would the hero have to be German? I mean, that's would you have to completely reverse the moral equation?
Right.
I think Angela Merkel would look nice in a white dinner jacket, actually. Yeah, well, I mean we're not on the right side at this current moment, and that makes, I think, perhaps maybe when your students were watching it too, it makes it doubly haunting.
Well, and also, I mean, I think to Alex's point that the analogies are hard to pursue. It's hard to, I mean, there's a kind of wonderful clarity in a lot of these movies that were made in the early years of the war to rally morale, to kind of
And there had to be. I mean, right. the offices that vetted the scripts, you know, the Office of War Information, for instance, in the Production Code Administration on the other side, but they made sure of this.
Right.
Things had to be clear. Yeah. It had to be clear, for instance, with regard to the other censorship body with the Hays Code, the PCA, that Ilza was operating under the assumption that her husband was dead. Right. You need to have that airdropped into the 9-minute flashback that she thinks he's dead. Otherwise, absolutely not.
Right.
Adultery just would not be tolerated. But yes.
So I wonder, just thinking about that effort. I mean, what was sort of part of the kind of the, not in at all a bad sense, the propaganda, the propagandistic intentions of this movie. Now there's a lot of attempt. I mean, you see filmmakers, principally documentary filmmakers, trying always to kind of to raise awareness and to tell refugee stories, and in some ways to get people involved, get people engaged, get people off the fence. But I wonder also about how that has changed, how those efforts, I mean, in a way. We're so saturated with information about some of the very worst things that are going on now. The people drowning in the Mediterranean or being gassed in Syria. That it can be very hard to think about how a film or how any other narrative or representation could create that kind of moral awakening, say, that Casablanca is trying for.
Well, I'd be interested, Tony, in your students. Did they may have seen it as political, but did they take away a message from it of being more dedicated to the refugee cause, or was it more about America being the great power? What was the political message they saw in it?
I think it was interestingly complicated, because they saw sort of the whole story about Rick as being the story that it's always been about, that, you know, you do the right thing. You sort of you find your ethical compass and you follow it. You see that people are suffering and in need of assistance, and that you have to help them in some way. And that's an idea that I think for these students and a lot of young people is a very, very available and powerful idea.
And by the way, I think that is the policies of the Trump administration on refugees do not represent the majority view of Americans. I mean, that's very clear from all the polling data. Americans are in favor of refugee programs. So that continues of taking in the needy. How that message is portrayed and how you rally support for that has always been problematic for the refugee community because there are two stories. One is the poor, helpless refugee who needs our assistance, right? But then you sort of objectify the refugee as not able. And the other is the refugee as agent who can take control of their lives, but then maybe they don't need as much help. And the refugee community is always sort of going back and forth between these two messages to try to work out the right way to mobilize people. I think it was the picture really of Aylin Curdy, the boy who was found dead on drowned on the Turkish beach that probably rallied Germany and Europe as a whole to the refugee cause. That's one of these awful pictures, not one of agency, but one of need and dire need that worked at that moment.
I'm hoping you mentioned documentary films. That there's this installation that I mentioned in the piece in the Daily Beast by a South African-born video artist. She's going to show her work now at the Venice Biennale this year. Her name is Candice Brights, and the piece is it's a seven screen installation called Love Story, and you have these seven refugees telling their stories on screen, and then after they tell their stories, you have Alec Baldwin and Julianne Moore inhabiting their positions and telling the stories in their voices. And it's a very moving, parts of it was shown here at Parsons in Genevieve Yu and So Young Yoon's course back in the fall, and I had the pleasure of watching it. But it's about to be installed at the Nationalgalerie in Berlin. But so, I mean, it's not necessarily apt to reach a popular audience, but I'm hoping that more people will continue to do this kind of work, which is consciousness raising, which is agitation, which is, I think, really, really important at this moment in time.
Well, and I think there's often, I think now especially, and I think in the past too, there's been a tension between, or even an argument sometimes, between the impulse to show the reality in its kind of most raw and harsh and unfiltered state, the kind of the documentary mm-hmm. impulse to bear witness, so that I think four of the five nominees for the documentary short subject at the Oscars this year dealt in some way with the refugee yeah. crisis. Three about Syria and one that was actually made under the auspices of the New York Times Op Docs program about the Coast Guard in Greece. You know, mm-hmm. Going out and
yeah,
4.1 miles out.
Stream.
And but then there's also the impulse, which I think Casablanca kind of presents, to tell the story in a more accessible, in a more kind of to use the charisma of movies and Hollywood and movie stars to get a message across, which is nowadays I think a much more controversial and as we say kind of problematic impulse, because it's and this was something that my students mm-hmm. noticed a lot of that you know, we're dealing with an elite stratum of refugees. You're also in a city on the African continent in which you see very few of the native residents of mm-hmm. that city, except occasionally, you know, in Sydney Green Streets.
Right, donning his fez and doing his best to go native.
Yeah, and Victor Leslo is the classic refugee, right? The targeted, persecuted person who's fleeing, and that's of course not the 4.5 million Syrians who fled. A number of them were targeted and persecuted, and there were certain minorities that particularly people went after, but a lot of them were simply fleeing conflict and violence, and that is a different picture.
They probably don't wear a well-pressed cream-colored double-breasted suit either. And Victor Laszlo, one of the points that's made, I think it's by the filmmaker Mark Rapaport, who says that, you know, he's the refugee you want to bring home, you know, to bring home to mom. And there was fear, just to be, to with all fairness, to Warner Brothers and specifically to Hal Wallace. This is one of his signature productions. He was worried that they looked too, that they both, and including in the wardrobe of Ilse Lund, of Ingrid Bergman's Ilse, he was concerned that this would give the wrong impression. And I think they tamped it down a little bit. So, but it's.
Well, she had 2 weeks in Marseille, apparently, to buy
right, those things. Exactly. I think this might be a good time to open things up with your permission, dear Tony.
Absolutely.
I think there are people who probably have some questions.
There, I see two microphones.
Yes, there are microphones. Or Anne Lou, right behind you, there's a microphone. I saw her and flash right up. And we can field some questions. And then afterwards have casual conversations. There's also a book table over there. And we could do some of that as well. But go ahead, Anne Lou, please.
I guess I was just really free associating and thinking as you were talking about the differences in today. And what I was thinking is, in this story, it's all about getting people out. And that's the end of the story. That's the good ending. And that's not where we are today, you know. And so to me, the biggest difference is that, yes, there's the trying to get out. Yes, there's the waiting. Yes, there's the terrible travel. But there's no America on the hill anywhere, really, for all these people. So it feels as if that we are watching some kind of fantasy of something that may speak to the present, but really didn't feel that way to me watching it. I felt much more like this is not a refugee movie, this is a romance. You know, I went back, just my own personal response was quite different because of how the story ends here, mm-hmm. and how that's so much of the story today is so much past it. So it's just a reflection on that.
Well, the romance is not resolved, but the refugee story is. Right, they board the plane, and if they were there to take them as the great refugee couple a la Hollywood night circa 1942, they board the plane and they're off. And maybe that, you know, people speak of the bittersweet romance, and that's the thing that they kind of cathect to, or that's that they remember most. And I think it's unresolved status that makes it more complex, and makes it kind of maybe remain lodged in one's mind a bit more than this refugee story. The refugee story, that dialogue between Herr and Frau Leuchtag when they're rehearsing their English for America, I mean, it sort of poked fun at what you do, but there too, I mean, oh yeah, you'll get along beautifully in America, but we don't know what really awaits them. And we just sort of need to smile and nod our heads the way that Carl the waiter does. You want to say
something? Well, I'm not the film guy. I'm the refugee guy. But I'm going to make a film point as a lay film guy. You know, it's funny as I see the thing about the movie. In some ways, the romance disappears because he doesn't end up with her in where the true love is. And what comes out, I think, is what Tony said, and what really comes out of your book, Noah, which is that this was it was really about America at the end. It's the disgruntled American who is slow to get to the fight, but once he gets to the fight, he becomes a hero. And to me, the movie ends much more about Rick as hero than it does as resolved refugee story or resolved romance.
I mean, that's Barbara Deming, the title of that wonderful piece that she wrote called The Reluctant Hero. Right. Really, really fleshes that out using Rick Blaine as
and it's fascinating that the word that Renaud uses to describe Rick at the sort of the awakened, engaged Rick is patriot.
Yeah,
which is a really such an interesting resonant word because he's not French. He doesn't mean necessarily a patriot in the cause of France specifically, but something else.
So let me make the refuge point, Tony, and get back to your question you had asked before, or maybe it came up something I said about how we tell the story today. There's been a lot of work now done by communications guys, not necessarily movie makers, but what kind of message do we portray, and what kind of ads can we use to get people to rally to the cause? And what they have found is that, again, it's the American hero story. There were a number of spots that were done about Canadians who had accepted into their homes refugees. And so they found the focus was, if you tell the story of a troubled refugee who's in bad shape, we've seen that. If you tell the story of someone who says, and the whole focus is on the host, that my life has been changed by accepting a refugee into my home, that resonates with people and gets people then to say, I want to be a part of that. And maybe that's a slight, I mean, that's also the part here of the, maybe I'm stretching things here, but it's a bit of the focus on the good guy who steps up at the end to help is where we really feel the impact.
that transformation when Rick tells Helmut Dantine, who plays Jan Brandl, Anina's naive husband, to put all those chips on 22, is that transformation, right? He moves from being this cynical isolationist, or at least a professed isolationist, to doing the right thing and doing it to help out those refugees. They are the Bulgarian refugees. You had a hand.
Thank you. I'm fascinated with the character of Sam. Mm-hmm. America is segregated, and there's no backstory at all to Sam, how he became this loyal friend to Rick. And I showed this film to a group of high school students, and many of them were African-American, and they brought up, wouldn't it be interesting if this film is told from Sam's point of view, starring Denzel Washington? You know, and I said, I thought it was a fabulous observation. And I was wondering, has there been anything written on Sam as almost loyal, obedient? Where did he come from? Does he have a family? What experiences has he had, et cetera?
Yeah. Well, a great question, a great point. A lot of Sam's communication is done, again, I referenced the refugee glance from Erich Maria Remarque. Sam's glances tell a great deal. He knows a lot. We don't get his full story, but the moment that he sees Ilse walk into Rick's, we see his eyes, we see him roll his eyes, we see him look at her. We see that over and over again. As for Arthur Dooley Wilson, who plays Sam, there's been a decent amount written on him. I did some work up at the Schomburg Center up in Harlem, and I was very happy to stumble upon the review when the film came out in the Amsterdam News. And reading from the vantage point of this was an editor and critic in the Amsterdam News, what a performance like Sam. Because Sam still says boss, and he says Mr. Rick calls him sir, and they're clearly friends. And they drink together, they raise a glass together. Ilse Lund, a white woman allegedly from Oslo, but fine. So Ilse Lund from Oslo raises her glass to Sam as well. When the picture played in the theaters uptown, not only would they play it through, but they would then go back to scenes in which Dooley Wilson plays, and they play them over again. The review in the Amsterdam News was so affirmative in terms of the degree of complexity, despite the fact that we don't get Sam's full story, the degree of complexity. He's not playing a Pullman porter. He's not a domestic. He is a friend. He is a confidant. And the tone of the review, I mean, I wasn't expecting to find this, but it was really basically exhorted the readers of the Amsterdam News, you've got to go out and you've got to see this picture because you need to see Arthur.
Did they say anything about these refugees are going to a racist country? A brutally, 1939, 40, the country, Jim Crow, it's a Jim Crow country.
Right.
And Sam seems incredibly content in his situation. And I'm seeing it from a 21st century point of view.
I understand.
And
So Arthur Dooley Wilson, he played in a band called the Red Devils, and they toured throughout Europe. He was a drummer. He didn't know how to play the piano, so that's Elliot Carpenter. So it was in the Elliot Carpenter papers at the Schomburg Center that I was working, and Elliot Carpenter was a studio musician at Warner's, and he's playing off screen. So Dooley wasn't just going through the motions. Anyway, they toured Europe. One of the reasons they toured Europe in the 20s and 30s was to get the hell out of America. And the fact that this plays is set in North Africa, Hollywood could get away with more, setting it in North Africa than they could at home. Film historian Tom Doherty makes a wonderful point that integration works when you're on the lot at Warner's and you're conveying a scene in North Africa. This friendship works, but otherwise. Look, it wouldn't have played in the Jim Crow South, that's for sure. And I'm not so sure how well it would have played in certain precincts in the North either. But it was considered a pretty bold move on the part of... And that, incidentally, Murray Burnett, to go back to that original playwright together with Joan Allison, when he wrote Everybody Comes to Rick's with Joan Allison, Sam was already a fully developed character. One of the reasons for this was, and I was rushing to get there, I wanted to make sure we had plenty of time to watch the movie, is that when they were in that smoky nightclub on the bluffs above Nice, There was a crooner from Chicago, an African-American, who was singing a medley of jazz standards. Among them, so the story goes, As Time Goes By, which is Murray Burnett's all-time favorite song that he listened to as an undergraduate at Cornell. And so Sam was already really a fully developed character in that stage play. Warners could have whittled him down, but they didn't. And in fact, Hal Wallace, who used to love to go to the Uptown Society Cafe, initially he wanted to actually have Lena Horne play Sam. He was very enamored of Lena Horne. He saw her perform there. And ultimately it came to Dooley Wilson. But it would be interesting to see, I mean, I don't know whether we'll do anything in the future. All these attempts at remake, as one of the sections of the book addresses, most, or if not all of them, ultimately fizzle. But it would be interesting to know the vantage point of Sam. Did you want to say something?
Just two quick questions. First of all, do you think the story today could be heard in the same light that it has been in this context, given that not only are we polarized in a political way, but also culturally, where the elite and liberal tend to be in far separation from the opposition, and even in such a place where Hollywood is being criticized politically? And the role that a movie like this plays back then is a little different because it's patriotic and is pro-America, whereas today's context, the refugee crisis isn't really American in any way. And then part two, you mentioned earlier that the story of people at home being changed by the refugee crisis is something that is something we latch onto a little more. And I think Come From Away, which is playing on Broadway right now, is a terrific example of that. And I think that's probably the one modern context of refugee or stranded people that could have an effect on the way people think about refugees.
One thing that's really striking about the old Hollywood of the 30s, of the years leading up to the wars, but of the Depression, too, is not all. I mean, it is the way that its own cosmopolitanism. The fact that there were all of these several generations really of migrants and emigres and refugees from Europe making the movies is also the cosmopolitanism of its frame of reference and how popular that was. So my favorite example of that is Shop Around the Corner, right? Which is wonderful. You know, some people think it's the greatest romantic comedy ever. Starring Margaret Sullavan and Jimmy Stewart, and it's set in Budapest. They're Hungarian. Jimmy Stewart is supposed to be Hungarian, and you sort of couldn't do that. And in a way, people would actors would get too hung up on doing the realistic accent or whatever, and you'd have to find a place to shoot it that you couldn't just build, you know, a little Budapest street on a back lot and settle for it that way. But Americans were much more insular and much more isolated then. People didn't go all over the world. And yet, somehow the mass audience was more receptive to and invited stories that were set. So there's so many studio comedies in the 30s in particular that are set in Paris or in Budapest or in Berlin or wherever that were huge, you know, that were not just aimed at a kind of a liberal elite, but at everyone. And in a way, the movies too, it were a much more powerful and a much more, in a way, universal medium than just because there was less competition. And so they could reach and were aimed at a kind of a mass audience in a way that they aren't quite anymore. So it's not just that the culture is polarized, but it's fractured and fragmented, and each one of us is kind of overloaded with demands on our attention, on our empathy, on our feelings. So it's kind of hard to imagine. It's also very, very hard to imagine, really, really hard to imagine, except in a scary way, the American state and the American military and Hollywood collaborating so closely. Maybe it's a good thing that they don't, but that was certainly, as Noah was saying, a huge part of the story of what was going on in Casablanca. And it's also the subject of this fantastic new Netflix documentary called Five Came Back, based on an amazing book by Mark Harris. Worth checking out. A really fascinating story. That partly because a lot of the people in it who are interviewed are current filmmakers, kind of reflecting on that time and how different it is from now, is a really interesting kind of place to explore that the question that you asked.
Thank you. There's time for one last question. You've got the mic, please.
Alex, this is for you. So the last questioner just said the refugee crisis is not American, but there was and still is an unaccompanied minor from sort of Central and South America crisis on the American border. What do you make of the fact that, I mean, the Trump administration is relatively new, but what do you make of the fact that in the last 8 years with a liberal left, you know, with President Obama, who was pro-refugees, that there was no use of, like, Hollywood? I mean, the conversation today has been about documentaries and kind of independent film, but this was a Hollywood movie trying to promote that. And what do you make of the fact, one, that the crisis on the American border is nothing that's really talked about, where people are basically saying the crisis is not American, even though there is a crisis in America, and the fact that Hollywood is not engaging in that in any kind of way?
Well, I would ask Noah to comment, and Tony, on the Hollywood side. Crisis is, it's not a crisis on the Southwest border. It's absolutely manageable if people had been let in and taken care of and permitted to apply for asylum. The government made it, the Obama administration made it into a crisis by detaining and deterring people fleeing violence in Central America, and that was done for political reasons to try to get an immigration bill passed. I disagreed with the policy that they adopted. So I'll fight with the word crisis. There's always been a difference in the refugee world between people arriving uninvited and people being brought in, right? So at the same time Obama was doing that on the Southwest border, he had raised the refugee admissions to the United States to 110,000, the highest in many years. Trump cut that to 50,000 with absolutely no explanation, and I think in a really terrible way, given the numbers all around the world. So when we were selecting people to bring in, the administration actually took the numbers quite high. But maybe you comment on, well, why hasn't Hollywood produced movies like this?
Funny, I got a call and I'm nervous about it. But I got a call from somebody at Fox Studios who's developing something, and I think she'd read the piece in the Daily Beast, and then she was doing. And said, oh, we want you to come and talk and meet with these people. And I'm fearing this kind of Barton Fink moment in Hollywood for me that's really on the horizon. So I don't know how this is going to actually shake out. But apparently they have something in development, and they're looking to do a story. I don't know the shape. I've not been made privy to the plot lines, even to the vague shape of the narrative. But apparently they're looking to do this at Fox. Maybe I've just given way too much information and...
So Tony,
the G-man will arrive at my door.
Am I allowed to do
that? Yeah,
okay. So do you think that Hollywood has the same impact on public opinion that it did then? So I'm thinking in the answer to the question earlier, suppose there were TV shows that featured Syrian refugees as kind of everyday characters, and we just got used to the idea of seeing them or other kinds of ways that people now get messages. Has Hollywood lost its privileged place as the creator of public opinion?
I don't think so. I mean, it's a very complicated, it's very hard to answer in a simple way. I mean, I think there is great intention. I mean, also just, you know, Hollywood is a lot of things. It's not just one thing. But I think there is a lot of sort of generally kind of sort of progressive intention there, and a desire to tell stories and make films and shows that that do good in the world in some way, that have some kind of positive impact. I tend to think that though that it when it works, because it would be foolish to say that movies and especially television shows have no impact or no influence on the way people see the world or on what people think about it, but it's very rarely direct. I mean, I think, and I've always been curious about how it worked during the war, because there it was sort of a total effort where it wasn't just, okay, this one movie is going to make everybody, but it was a really kind of all out, and as the, you know, the filmmakers in Five came back, for example, were kind of sent on missions, were commissioned in the armed forces and sent off to make some of the documentaries were suppressed because they were telling a story about the war that the Office of War Information didn't want to get out. But I think that absent that kind of concentrated propagandistic effort, which again I'm not sure is something we want or ask for, it's a much more diffuse thing. I mean, I think it works much more in just the sort of the slow shift in attitudes. And I think it's always a little bit of a chicken egg question, you know, whether Hollywood or movies are reflecting or influencing public opinion. But I do think it is both. But it's almost impossible to pinpoint. I mean, there are very few instances in history going all the way back where you can say, ah, well, this, you know, this movie had this effect. Mm.
I want to thank everyone for coming out tonight. I want to thank Tony and Alex. We have books over there in case anyone is interested. We can carry the conversation on casually, but thank you so much for making it here to this event.